What's up, guys? I'm here in the hotel of in the Marriott. I want to talk to you guys about the K system. Now, I had a request from John Starfisher, one of my subscribers, and he was like, I want to know more about the K system. And the K system is great if you, I think it's the most important thing after acoustic treatment. So once you got your room treated, the most important thing you can do when it comes to recording is getting your levels right. Now, your levels are more than just your gain staging. It's also the loudness of your speakers in your room. Now, that's important, and that's what the K system is all about. Your gain staging should always be around minus 20 RMS, and that's because it gives you more headroom for your peaks. Now, the K system is predicated on that because minus 18 dBFS, that's full scale and digital, correlates to 0 dBVU in the analog world. So if you ever decide that you want to use analog equipment, or you might use some now, this is going to make sure that your levels are compatible. The K system, you're going to need a few things. One is a pink noise file. Contrary to popular belief, it really doesn't matter which pink noise file you use. Bob Katz has his filtered pink noise available from his site, but it's a little bit harder to find, and a lot of people don't even use it. Even Sound on Sound recommends typical standard pink noise. You need pink noise, you need speakers in a room, obviously, and you also need some sort of sound pressure meter, like a Radio Shack one or an app in your phone. It doesn't matter what you use, but for your sound pressure meter, it needs to be set to C-weighted, slow response. And you need a listening position, and you need your room all set up. So once you got all that in a DAW, or some software with meters in it, so you can, you know, play your file, loop it, whatever. So there's two versions of the K system, okay? There's the old one, which is calibrated to RMS values, and now Bob Katz is recommending conformity to the R128 standard, and that's for broadcast. The ballistics are a little bit different. There's also filtering for the frequencies, which are a little bit different than the old RMS system. So for the RMS system, what you do is you set your pink noise in your DAW to minus 20 RMS, and you play that back in your room with your sound pressure meter at your listening position, and then you set it to a level that's comfortably loud. Now, you might have heard that 85 decibels is the correct volume, but 85 decibels is way too loud for most home recording situations because your rooms are smaller. 85 decibels is more for like a 10,000 cubic foot room. My room that I'm currently in, well, not this one because this is a hotel and it's huge, but in my apartment is just over 2,500 foot cubed. And that's good. It's the minimum requirement for music. The minimum requirement for podcasting or any kind of vocal work is 1,500 foot cubed. So you got to do a measurement in your room and see what it is. But basically, the smaller your room, the quieter you can have it. You should have it in order to get it comfortably loud. And again, you could concern yourself with exact decibel levels, but just like the pink noise, there's going to be tolerance. You might be comfortable with 74 decibels. You might be comfortable with 76. You might be more comfortable with 72, but you do want it comfortably loud, because if you have it too loud, you're not going to be comfortable and you're not going to want to work at that level. And if it's too quiet, you run the risk of not having the flattest response with your ears because of the Fletcher-Munson curve. Some of the things that the K system will help you with is, by having a consistent level, it's going to ensure that your mixes are going to be as consistent as possible. And also, when you're listening to frequency response of your mix or other mixes, having it at a consistent level will help you recognize any aberrations from what your targets are. Also, because of the way the K system works, you're always listening at the same volume, no matter how much headroom you have in your project. So that's where the K20 comes in, the K14, etc. Whereas the higher the K number, the more headroom you have. And essentially, the quieter the project is in the DAW, and you compensate by turning up your monitors. Now, if you want it to be a louder file, so that way when I play it on my phone or it gets played somewhere else, then you want to use a K system with a smaller number, which basically correlates to less headroom and a higher RMS value, but more compressed and more potential for distortion. You know, once you get your head around that, it's easy to understand, and the best way to understand it is to actually get started and calibrate your room. So again, don't concern yourself about exactly what pink noise file you use. Don't concern yourself with exactly what SPL meter you use. Don't concern yourself with exactly what the decibel level is. The main thing that's important is that you use the same noise file and you use the same decibel meter and the same position in your room. That's the thing that matters the most, because it's all about repeatability. In order to calibrate, I'll first walk you through the old system and then the new system second. So get your pink noise file. You can, again, use Bob Katz, or what I recommend is you download the Melda Production free bundle. It has a noise generator, and you want your noise to play through just one speaker. So in your stereo system, your sub can be on, but you do your left speaker first and then your right speaker. So set it to where it's playing and either turn it up on the monitor itself or use a digital controller or a hardware controller, and it needs to be repeatable. So if it's on the back of your speaker, obviously that's the worst option. In Mac, you have audio MIDI settings. You can go in there and set it digitally. And what I found is that those decibel increments translate pretty well into your actual room. Get an RMS meter. You can use the K meter demo, although it's only calibrated at K14. And this is why I recommend the K System V2, which uses the R128 standard. But any kind of RMS meter is fine. Just make sure you always use the same one. So set your pink noise to play at minus 20 dB full scale RMS. Turn just one speaker on, or have the noise just go to one side. And then set up your sound level meter at your listening position. And turn up the volume of the speaker itself so it's playing at the calibrated level that you want. Whether that's 74 decibels or 76 decibels, again, it's up to you. Just make sure it's consistent. Once you have one speaker, do the second one, same thing. Now you're set to K20. In order to do K14, and from there you can extrapolate and figure out how to do the other scales, what you do is you raise the volume of the noise in your computer. Okay, now this is important because this means you have a louder signal, but it's going to be louder in your room too. So what you do is you compensate and turn down your monitors in your room so the actual volume in your room is quieter. And this is what creates the consistent level that you're listening at, regardless of how hot the signal is in your computer. So turn up the noise to minus 14 RMS, turn down your speakers while your sound level meter is measuring, and turn down your speakers until it says the exact same decibel level as it did when you were doing K20. So that's how you do the RMS. That's the old version. Now, what Bob Katz is currently recommending, and what I use, is the new R128 standard. And all you have to do that is get an R28 compliant meter, and that's included in the Melda Production free bundle. So just set that meter up, and you're gonna notice the levels are a little bit different. But you use that, you enter in K20 as your loudness unit full scale value, let your pink noise play for a few seconds, because it takes about 3 seconds to get a short-term loudness level, but a little bit longer to get the correct integrated loudness. So play your levels the exact same way. They will be a little bit different, but again, it's not whether you use RMS or use R128. The important thing is that you have the same noise, the same meter, the same loudness meter in your computer, and also the same decibel meter at the same position in your room. This gives you that repeatability, so you're always hearing music at the calibrated volume. And this will help you, for instance, if you're mixing, some people ask, well, how loud should I mix if I want to get my low end correct? How loud should I mix if I want to get my vocals correct? Well, someone might say loud or quiet, but that's like saying how long is a piece of string, short or long. But if you know that your calibrated piece of string is 10 inches, then a short piece of string is obviously shorter than 10 inches. And just like that with decibels, if you know 74 decibels in your room is comfortably loud, and you want to listen quietly to set your levels, then you know it's got to be quieter. And if you want to listen loudly to check if your highs are too harsh or your bass is too extreme, then you can turn your levels up beyond that for louder. So that's what this is all about. Consistent levels, whether that's the balance of a particular instrument, EQ levels, also making sure that you're always hearing compression at the same level, because obviously louder sounds better. So if you turn up your volume with a compressor, sounds better. And just like that, a louder track will sound better than your mix. So if you're comparing a reference to a mastered mix, obviously the master will be louder. But if you always calibrate it to a set RMS integrated value, you got repeatability and you're comparing apples to apples the best you can. So thank you, John Starfisher, for that request. I hope this was helpful and clear. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and consider supporting me on Patreon. That would help me a lot. Thank you. See you in the next video.